السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer, the one who is in absolute control of every aspect of existence. We thank him for giving us this blessed month of Ramadan, the year 1435 after the hijrah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Indeed, we are so thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having given us in the past the opportunity to go through the stories of the prophets, may peace be upon them, as well as the story of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may peace be upon him and all his companions. And this year, we have chosen to go through the lives of our true heroes, the companions of Muhammad, may peace be upon him, and may the blessings of the Almighty be upon them all. And to start with, it is only important for us to look at the best of the lot, the one who was the most outstanding, the one who is undisputed, or it is not disputed that he is the best of the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tread this earth after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all the other prophets of Allah. What we would term أفضل من مشى على الأرض بعد الأنبياء, the best of those who tread this earth after the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His name was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. May Allah's pleasure be upon him. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu is a name that we all know, but some of us may not be aware of the fact that his real name was Abdullah. Abu Bakr was a pet name or a pen name, something known as a kunya in the Arabic language. So As-Siddiq was also a title given to him later on. Abdullah, his father's name was Uthman, known also as Abu Quhafa. So he was known as Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa or Abdullah ibn Uthman. Abu Bakr As-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the greatest of all. It is important for us to know why he is the greatest of all. We will spend, inshallah, on a daily basis, 30 minutes of your time after Salatul Taraweeh to explain to you the lives of some of these companions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah to accept it from us all. His mother was known as Ummul Khair, Salma bint Sakhr. She was known as Ummul Khair, and there is a beautiful story about her that we shall hear in a few moments. He was born in Makkah al-Mukarramah 2 years after the year of the elephants. And I'm sure you're aware that the year of the elephants was the year when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. So he was approximately 2 to 2.5 years younger than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a person who was loved during his teenage years, and even during the period of ignorance, he was well loved by all. He was the one who had very great character and conduct, and he always carried himself in a very respectful way, even prior to Islam. He was a friend of Muhammad, may peace be upon him, even prior to prophethood. And this is a very great aspect of the life of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu that is worth mentioning. He always followed that which was clean and pure. It is reported that even prior to Islam, he never drank alcohol. He was once asked about these intoxicants, and he made a clear statement saying that I would like to protect my dignity and my reputation. And I have seen others whom, when they drink alcohol, they lose their dignity, they lose their reputation. And for that reason, I will not do something that will make me lose my dignity or my reputation. I stop for a moment and ask the question to us all. How many of us are prepared to leave that which will result in the loss of our dignity and our reputation? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Indeed, we have Islam in front of us that has already taught us, if you follow this path, it will result in your dignity and reputation being intact. And if you are to lose the path or you are to turn away, perhaps the dignity and reputation will be lost. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness in terms of our own reputation and our dignity. May He forgive our shortcomings and may He grant us a lesson. He was such an honest and upright businessman. He traveled the east to the west in terms of the Arabian Peninsula. He went to many countries, many areas, many places. Today, if we were to put a mark, we would find so many countries. He traveled these lands in order to do business. And every time he was known as an upright person wherever he went. This is also something we need to ask ourselves. When we do our business, how upright are we? It is something we learn from the lives of the companions. Here, the life of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He was a person who was very knowledgeable regarding the lineage of the Arabs. He knew the people's families and their lineages up to their forefathers and beyond. So he would tell anyone and everyone from Quraysh who exactly they were. Today, we do not even know our own lineage. Sometimes we do not know how a relative of ours is related to us, myself included. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Islam makes it a duty upon us to fulfill the rights of kinship. How are we going to fulfill the rights of kinship when we don't even know who is related to us? Take a look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. May Allah's mercy and peace be upon him and may Allah be pleased with him. He was such a powerful man. They called upon him in order to express the lineage and they knew when he said something, it was accurate. This was something he was gifted regarding. And he had a habit. Never did he speak bad about other families. Never did he speak bad about the lineage of others. Your tribe is like this and your little clan was like that, mentioning bad things. He always mentioned good things, radiallahu anhu. We learn a lesson. If you want to be loved by the people, mention good things, inshallah. He was loved by his people before Islam because he only spoke good about the others. Even if he knew that there was something bad in a particular group of people or in a certain family, he always tried to make mention of the good. From this, I learned something and I hope you do too. That every single person has goodness in him or her. If you are to search it, you will find it. Prefer to speak about the goodness of others rather than to speak about the evil that some may have done. May Allah forgive us all and grant us a beautiful tongue with which we can remember Allah, with which we can actually make mention of the beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and with which we do not hurt others. May Allah grant us a beautiful tongue that we can actually be saved from entering hellfire because of the way we use the tongue. We use it correctly. Once Umar ibn al-Khattab, and this was later on in the life of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he walked into the presence of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and he found him holding his tongue. So he asked him, why are you holding your tongue? He stuck his tongue and he understood that these idols do not feed me. They do not benefit me. They hold no harm against me. Why do I worship, or why would I worship these idols? So this was also one of the merits of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He was a man who had traveled a lot and he was loved by all, as we made mention of a few moments ago. Also, what is important of making mention of is there came a time in his life just before he entered the fold of Islam when his net worth was 40,000 silver coins. This is the type of man he was. He was a wealthy man. Wealthy as in not arrogant, but he understood that this wealth is a gift to me from my maker. And I need to spend it in the right path. This he understood when he accepted Islam. So what is the story of this man accepting Islam? Such a good man, such a powerful man, such a loved man even prior to Islam. How did he enter the fold of Islam? Well, when Muhammad, may peace be upon him, was granted prophethood by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Quraysh began to speak. And they started saying, here is the man, he is swearing our idols. Yet it was not actually swearing, it was only belying, which means he said these idols are false and worshipping the idols is wrong. They took it as swearing. So he said, they said that he is swearing our idols and at the same time he is belying what the forefathers have come with, and at the same time he is speaking ill of whatever we've been doing in terms of the culture that we have. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu heard this. And there was a time just before that when he used to search for the right religion. Because as we said, he was not from those who bowed down or worshipped the idols. He did not bow down to the idols, nor did he worship them. And he always searched. Whenever he traveled, he would ask people of different faiths, what is it that you believe? And he would compare it with what his people believed. And he would try to figure out what was more correct. He knew the most about Christianity compared to other religions. And he always was in search of the truth, so much so that one day he had seen a dream and he asked a certain man in Asham regarding the interpretation of his dream. It is reported that it is the same monk that Muhammad, peace be upon him, was told, or his uncle or his grandfather was told at the time, that you know what, be careful, this young man is actually going to be a prophet later on. He told Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, where are you from? He says, I am from Mecca. Which tribe are you from? He says, from Quraysh. He said, is this the dream that you saw? He said, yes. If that is the case, there will be a prophet from amongst you and you will be one of his prime companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness. This was one of the things that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu made mention of later on. So as he was searching, he was seated near the Kaaba. And with him was a man known as Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail. And suddenly, a certain poet passed. The poet's name was Umayyah ibn Abi Salt. He was a well-known poet at the time, and he was an upright individual. He did not engage in evil. Umayyah ibn Abi Salt, his poetry is so powerful that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he would have been a Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the true acceptance of Islam in a way that not only do we utter it with our mouths, but we actually follow it. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was seated and he looked at Umayyah ibn Abi Salt, and they had communication between the two of them because they used to search for the truth. So Umayyah asks him, have you found anything, any goodness? He says, well, I am upon goodness, but we have not yet found the goodness. So Umayyah then made mention of the fact that there will be a prophet coming from amongst you, either from your tribe or mine. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was impatient. He ran to Waraqah ibn Nawfal. Waraqah ibn Nawfal, the man whom Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiallahu anha took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to when prophethood had come to him. So when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went to Waraqah ibn Nawfal, he asked him, this is what Umayyah is saying. I don't know that there is going to be a prophet from amongst us, Abu Bakr says radiallahu anhu. So Waraqah says, according to the books and according to the previous revelations, there is supposed to be a messenger that will come from this particular place. And it is about time that he has come, or he will be coming very, very soon. So all this having been made mention of, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was spoken about by Quraysh that he has now claimed prophethood, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went to him. And he was the first of the free men who had gone up to him and said, oh Muhammad, you're a friend of mine. We grew up together. I know you. You are truthful. You are honest. What is this that Quraysh is speaking about you? They are saying that you are a person who is claiming prophethood, or you are a person who has sworn our idols. You are a person who has disagreed with what our forefathers have been doing. You are a person who has been saying this and that. He looked at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He says, oh Abu Bakr, I would like to inform you that I am a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has revealed to me that none should be worshipped but Him and Him alone. And the worship of idols is wrong. And the worship of all these other deities is absolutely incorrect. And I am warning you about the same thing. So I am calling you to this belief. Immediately Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu said, I bear witness that you are indeed the Prophet of Allah, and I worship Allah alone, and Him alone shall I worship. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. May He make us from those who can surrender as readily as Abu Bakr surrendered. He heard it and he knew it's correct immediately. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors of guidance. Imagine he said, yes, I know you. You will not tell the truth. If we've believed you about everything prior to this, then this particular item is of far greater importance. We know, and I bear witness, you would not lie to me. So he was the first from amongst the free men who accepted Islam. This was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Thereafter, another great distinguishing factor of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu is after he accepted Islam, he called a lot of his friends towards Islam. He went to them one by one and he spoke to them, look, worship Allah alone, worship your maker alone, leave these idols and false deities. They bring you no harm, no goodness. Remember, it is your maker alone that you should be worshipping. And they began to accept one by one. I am going to mention to you a few of the names of those powerful companions of Muhammad, peace be upon him, who accepted Islam through the effort of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr being the first from amongst the free men who accepted the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The others who had accepted by the effort of Abu Bakr were Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, Talha ibn Ubaidillah radiallahu anhu, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Mad'un radiallahu anhu, Abu Ubaidah, Amir ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu, as well as Abu Salama ibn Abd al-Asad, Al-Arqam ibn Abi al-Arqam radiallahu anhuma, and he spoke to his family members as well. So his wife Ummu Ruman accepted Islam, and his children who were there at the time, and even those to follow, accepted Islam. This was the effort of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. How many of us have spoken to our companions, those whom we work with, those whom we come across on a daily basis about Islam? Sometimes we are too embarrassed, but we don't know. The best of those who treaded this earth after the Prophet, the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was Abu Bakr. One of the great efforts he made was on those whom he interacted with, and he brought them one by one. So I call you, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. We are calling towards worshipping the maker alone and not associating deities with that particular maker. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from them, and may he make us from those who call to him. Ameen. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he was the first who got up and lectured in public, calling people towards Islam. He was the first who got up in public to call people towards what was right and to explain to them what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam had brought. And this is what happened. When 38 men had accepted Islam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and told him, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, don't you see we're on the right path? Why don't I get up? Why don't we get up and come out to the open and speak to the people and tell them openly, declare Islam openly? And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wait, we are still in a stage of weakness. We can hold on. It is not yet the right time. And after some time, he gave him the permission. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu got up in the masjid, one of the corners of the masjid not as we know it today, but just near the Kaaba. And he got up and he spoke about Islam, and he spoke about how bad the worshipping of idols is, and how wrong the forefathers were when they were worshipping idols, and superstitious behavior that they engaged in. And immediately the people of Quraysh began to swear him, they began to mock at him, and Utbah ibn Rabi'ah began to beat him up with one of his shoes. And he beat him so much that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu lay unconscious. He continued beating Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu until his tribesmen came, and they were known as Banu Taym, the people of Taym. When they came in and they stopped him, they took this man away and they said, stop beating him. And he was laying unconscious. Banu Taym kept on speaking to him so that when he answered them, they knew this man is alive. And the mother of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, her name was Ummul Khair. What happened to her? Something amazing. She looked after her son at that particular time when he was unconscious, and just when he gained consciousness, she looked after him and she tried her best to feed him, and she tried her best to give him some water. But every little while he would ask, how is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He thought that they must have harmed him as well. So he wanted to know, more importantly, how is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing? And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu refused to eat or to drink. So Umm al-Khair, his mother, she asks him, how am I meant to know what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is doing? And remember, she was not a believer yet. So he said, ask Bint al-Khattab, Umm Jamil Bint al-Khattab, the daughter of Umar. Ask her, she would know. So Umm al-Khair, the mother of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, got to Umm Jamil Bint al-Khattab. This is the daughter of Umar bin al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And asked her, what do you say, what is it with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How is he? My son is asking about him. She said, I don't even know your son, and I don't even know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when she told her the story, immediately the daughter of Al-Khattab, this was the sister of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, she asked, okay, where is he? Because she found out that he was now unconscious. So subhanallah, she was taken to him and she explained that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is okay. Well, where is he right now? He is in the house of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam. Take me there, I want to see him, says Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So he was taken there. And when he saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he was so happy, that is when he decided to have a drink and that is when he ate something, subhanallah. Look at the love he had for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the very beginning. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu at that particular time looked at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, this mother of mine has been so kind to me, call her towards Islam and pray for her. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke with her a few words, calling her to Islam. She accepted Islam. Subhanallah. She immediately said, this is my son. You are a friend of my son. I am accepting this and I know and I bear witness you are a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she was also from amongst those who accepted Islam. Now comes the life of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu after this. He could not bear people suffering. He was a person who cried a lot. He was very thin and fair in complexion. He was very thin. His shoulders were not broad. He was an extremely thin, small person. And subhanallah, he loved people so much. Goodness for them he loved so much that he tried to call them towards Islam. And those who entered Islam, who were being persecuted, he always wanted to reach out to them to help them. From amongst them was Bilal ibn Rabah. He was a slave of Umayyah ibn Khalaf. And when he accepted Islam, his master happened to harm him so much, not only threaten, but actually inflict so much of harm on him that Bilal ibn Rabah was pulled through the hot desert sand with rocks on his chest. And he was made to suffer so much. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu is the one who went to Umayyah ibn Khalaf and told him, listen Umayyah, what are you getting by harming this man? I will buy him off you. And I will pay you for him, or I will give you one in return. You can take one who is not a Muslim, or I will pay you for him. The deal was struck. And Bilal ibn Rabah was bought by Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu and freed as a Muslim. And this is when the suffering had stopped. So this man was a person who used to cry a lot. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu used to weep a lot. And he was a person who was soft-hearted. He, from amongst those whom he freed was Amir ibn Fuhayra and Umays and Zinnira, who was the slave girl at the time. When she was freed, her as well, she lost her eyesight. Allahu anhu, in these verses, that remember, if you are not going to help the messenger, Allah has already helped him in the past. When he was the second of two in that particular cave, who were the two? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah was the third. Allah assisted them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assisted them with an army. With an army that you were unable to see. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assist us as well. And may He make us from those who are constantly in remembrance of Him. So these were some of the goodness, or some of the points of goodness during the hijrah that had occurred that became a virtue of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Regarding the wars and the battles that took place thereafter. Remember, the people of Makkah had usurped the wealth of the Muslimin. And there came a time when this wealth was being returned through the battles that took place. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu did not miss a single battle with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, starting from Badr, counting through all the battles right up to the end. He took part in every single one of them. And inshallah, tomorrow we will go through the sickness of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam towards the end of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What exactly happened? And we will make mention of a few more stories.